Work out here in our consumer power base. No major industry, just miles and miles of parking space.
Now, what's a good angry song that from the old days? It's a good. We all come from bar bands. We all played in clubs. Oh no, not one of mine. No. The stuff we, huh? Oh yeah. Wait, good times, bad times. What key is that? Wait, how about? Wait, let's get the tempo first.
In the days of my youth, I was just what it means to be a man. Now I've reached that age, I try to do all those things the best I
This is Brian Ruggles. Brian has been with us, with me, actually longer than anyone since 1970. Brian's been working with me. So. Just had a little baby girl, Kylie Rose. Hi, Kylie. What is this for? Is this so like, you know, like the PA system doesn't get pregnant or something? Is it? This is preventative. We all come, you know, from bands that played in bars and clubs, and you know, the music I write and the way we play, and they work with other people also, aside from me sometimes, comes from a culmination of a lot of different kinds of music, music that we grew up with, some of us who are older from the 60s, some of us... Crystal, we're really not sure how old you are, though. You, yeah, and we never will know. Crystal Type. And some of it from the 70s, but we all, you know, like when we have sound checks or we rehearse, a lot of times we never play Billy Joel stuff. It drives the sound guy crazy, and the PA people and the lighting people is like, do Billy Joel, will you? And we're like, I'm playing Cream. How does that go? Anyway, how does that go? I think people assume, you know, as a piano man, and that, you know, Billy Joel, he wrote that song, Piano Man, like, all I did all my life was playing Holiday Inns at piano bars, and I was in, like, rock and roll bands most of my life, and, I mean, that's the kind of stuff that I really liked Hendrix and Cream, and, but it doesn't translate to piano, you know, like, That's kind of dorky on the piano, or like a great Hendrix song. What's a
Purple Haze?
Okay, what key is that? What key? Is
it?
In the key, a guitar player's key, of course. Yeah, play Purple Haze. I'll give you these. Thank you. But that doesn't mean I can't. Because the last time I was, this guy asked me about teaching. Did I get here again? No, I didn't get here again yet. Okay, so. And I answered that young lady. Yes, actually, I that young lady asked me a question, and I answered your question to your satisfaction, hopefully. Let me go over to this side now. Okay, the fella here in the lighter gray shirt. Okay, because he looked really disappointed when I said the dark gray. Okay, the microphone's coming to you.
Do you ever go back to the bar that inspired Piano Man?
It was so long ago, it doesn't exist anymore. I went to, I'm not heartbroken about it, I hated the place. When I was working at this place, it's not really, L.A. now has got all these clubs and these places to hang out, but when I was there in the early 70s, it wasn't really a bar town. Like in New York, every corner has a bar. Every neighborhood has a bar. In the Northeast, it's like a bar area. Yeah, maybe it's the weather in the winter, everybody gets depressed and you gotta go to the bar, you know? But this was like a bar where people went after they lost at the track. You know, not a happy hour group of people, you know? And I would just play, they would go, do you know, you know, it was just, everybody was blasted, you know, and I wouldn't remember the bridge, which, and I'd just make up my own bridge. And nobody cared. So I only did the job for about 6 months, and I was making union scale, and I got tips with the brandy glass on the thing, but everybody was, you know, like, lost at the track. They didn't care what I played, you know, just... Don't sing too loud, that's all. So they care. They would pay me, like, don't do this song that you did last night. Here's $5. Said, sure, exactly. You got it, you know? Disgraceland. It kind of grows on you. Okay. So... What's the question? About the bar. Okay, it was at the corner of Wilshire and Western in Los Angeles, and now I think it's like some big insurance building or bank building. It used to be called the Executive Room, and I went back there, and it's not there, and I'm thinking, did I dream the whole thing? But then again, the studio we recorded a lot of albums in 52nd Street no longer exists. What albums? I go walking in my sleep. We have what's Dave? What is that pressure? The song Pressure. Point it out. Now it's in a minor key. This is with the respect that I get treated with by the musicians. Now, give us an example of what. That's in a major key. You're missing all this. You should drop a mic on him. I remember we used to do, was it Just the Way We Are? We used to do it at sound check. They'd say, can you do Just the Way We Are? And we go like, don't go changing now. The drive is a... So when I get really old and I can't make more money in the arenas, we'll go to Las Vegas and be one of those whore acts, you know? So we'll just do like lounge versions of... Don't go changing, try and please me, no, no. You never let me down before. Dooby-dooby-doo, don't imagine. You're too familiar, I don't see you no more. And then Sinatra does the song. And he does it just like that. Yeah. Just... I ain't gonna go there. Anyway, so let me take another question. Okay, over on this side. Yeah, this fella right here.
In pressure, you seem to be talking about the pressures of life. Do you seem that the pressures of life are harder now as an established artist or when you were first starting out?
Oh, when I was first starting out. When I had, like, no money and no place to live. That was a lot tougher. You know, now it's all, like, the pressures you imagine. Oh, well, how do I make, you know, like, the money to pay the taxes on my millions that I've made? You know, that's really not that much pressure. It's, you learn to cope, I guess, as you go along. But I was... at one point in my life, when I was starting out, I had no gig. Musicians, you know, I remember reading, hi, Timothy, how you doing? I remember reading something about, I wrote this song, Allentown, which actually, we'll play right after this, which just happens to dovetail beautifully into this next piece we're going to do. I wrote this song, Allentown, and I read a review of it. It's like, who is this rock star guy to talk about unemployed people? And I'm thinking, hello, I'm a musician? Like, you don't think I know about being unemployed? Hello? You know, like, it's, we invented unemployment. Yeah, it's our word, actually. You know, before it was just bums, you know? But it was much, I mean, I had no place to live. I wasn't making any money. I was suicidal, I mean, at one point in my life, in my early 20s, which is a tough age anyway. But I can empathize, and I can relate to people who are having a hard time getting work and making a living. And I think it's more difficult now for people trying to not, who don't want to fit into a niche. For people who want to make their own way. Because the baby boom kind of invented a lot of stuff. You know, like we were making things up as we were going along. Now it's probably more rigid. It's probably more formatted. It's probably more like bean counters came along and figured out, well, you can only do this for a living. And if you step outside of that, you can't make a living. There's more pressure, in that respect. But like when a house cost, what our parents paid for a house, like... $50 or something, you know, and now a house is like $5 million, you know, like for a Levitt, you know, it's a Levitt starter kit, you know, it's like, and you got to be sitting there going, how will I ever have a house? So, yeah, in that respect, there's difficulty, but there has always been people who are having problems with making money and earning a living and getting along in the world. I think artists. Hopefully, speak for them. Artists are supposed to be communicators. Musicians are supposed to be communicators. And we're hopefully talking about the experiences they're having because we feel, you know, what they're going through. And I used to work in the Lehigh Valley a lot. Remember, we used to play all those college gigs? There's like 50 colleges in Lehigh Valley. And we used to play there. And I said, one of these days, I got to write a song about this place, Allentown. It seems to be its own place. And I started a song. I said, we're living in Allentown, and we're living here in Allentown, And then the steel industry took a dump, and the Rust Belt became a great source of financial difficulty for a lot of people in Northeast. And this is the song that came out of it. And it goes something like this. Mark Rivera, horn player, extraordinaire. I want to explain something in case there's been some confusion about what I'm doing now in my career. And I don't know how to work a computer. My daughter has a computer, and I know how to turn it on, and I know how to turn it off, and she wants me to pick up my email, because people send me email. And I get like fan mail, I get phone calls, I get mail, I get messages, I get, you know, faxes. I don't want no more mail. It's like a whole day of just reading the friggin' mail, you know? So I learned how to turn it off. I learned the computer off. And, but I understand that there's like all this discussion about, well, what's he doing? He's giving up music and he's not going to perform, or he's going to, he's not going to write songs anymore. And just to clarify what I'm doing, I've been writing instrumental music, piano pieces, orchestral pieces, music that doesn't have words for the last 3 years. And that's what I'm interested in doing right now. It doesn't mean I'm never going to write songs again. It doesn't mean I'm never going to write words again. It just means that's where my heart is right now. And I have to go where my heart tells me to go. And I'm enjoying doing that. Now, you notice nobody in the band applauded after that. Exactly. But it doesn't... Look, if I get an idea for a bunch of songs, you don't think I'm going to sit down and write these songs? I mean, if I get overwhelmed with song ideas... There's no business like show business, like no business. You're gonna need a fan or a hairdryer to dry me out. Everything about it is appealing. It will allow. Nothing can replace what happy feeling. And you are stealing that extra bow. Hey, okay. But I'm writing instrumental music, and now people are just okay. So when are you coming out with the Billy Joel classical album? I said, no. I'm writing. I'm not necessarily the guy to do this stuff. I'm writing, even the piano music I write, and I know this may be difficult to understand, I think there should be a better piano player to play this stuff. Because, right. See, here what happens, when you write, you write in increments. You don't write from A to Z. Probably one of the only people ever write the whole schmear from beginning to end was like Mozart. And he really pisses me off. He says, I'm such a genius. He was like Hendrix. He was from Mars or something. He was here and he wrote, and he just wrote from beginning to end, ha 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 ha, nobody else can do this. Ha, ha. So I died at 33, you know? Okay, goodbye. Burnt out. I write, you know, pieces of compositions in increments. But to play them from beginning to end, from A to Z, in a bravura, what they call bravura style, which is like with panache and virtuosic technique, takes a great classically trained pianist, and I'm only somewhat classically trained. So that's what I'm doing. So I don't have plans for a Billy Joel classical album. Some of this stuff is orchestral, will have to be done by an orchestra. Some of this stuff will have to be done by another pianist. But I'm just, at this point, I'm writing. I'm composing music, and I'm enjoying doing it. Now, we are going to tour next year. We're going to tour with Elton next year. So, he sings that part anyway, okay.